In the last segment, we talked about the first two-thirds of chapter 4, the famous chapter the Watchtower uses to this day to justify their doctrine of the last days, the last generation, beginning in 1914. Mm-hmm. But we want to look again closely at what conclusion does Nebuchadnezzar come to first before his experience of the 7 years of beast-like behavior, mm-hmm. and after, even after. So what is the grand conclusion when Nebuchadnezzar gets to the end of his humiliation? Mm-hmm. So we wanted to read this whole passage because the gems are just distributed really well in this
segment. We're reading from verse 28 to the end of chapter 4. All this befell Nebuchadnezzar, the king. At the end of 12 lunar months, he happened to be walking upon the royal palace of Babylon. The king was answering and saying, "Is not this Babylon the great that I myself have built for the royal house with the strength of my might and for the dignity of my majesty?" While the word was yet in the king's mouth, there was a voice that fell from the heavens. "To you it is being said, O Nebuchadnezzar the king, the kingdom itself has gone away from you, and from mankind they are driving even you away, and with the beasts of the field your dwelling will be. Vegetation they will give even to you to eat, just like bulls, and seven times themselves will pass over you, until you know that the Most High is ruler in the kingdom of mankind, and that to the one whom he wants to, he gives it." At that moment, the word itself was fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar, and from mankind he was being driven away, and vegetation he began to eat, just like bulls, and with the dew of the heavens his own body got to be wet, until his very hair grew long just like eagle's feathers, and his nails like bird's claws. And at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up to the heavens my eyes, and my own understanding began to return to me, and I blessed the Most High himself, the one living to time indefinite, and I praised the glorified, because his rulership is a rulership to time indefinite, and his kingdom is for generation after generation. And all the inhabitants of the earth are being considered as merely nothing, and he is doing according to his own will among the army of the heavens and the inhabitants of the earth. And there exists no one that can check his hand or that can say to him, "What have you been doing?" At the same time, my understanding itself began to return to me, and for the dignity of my kingdom, my majesty and my brightness themselves began to return to me. And for me, even my high royal officers and my grandees began eagerly searching, and I was reestablished upon my own kingdom, and greatness extraordinary was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, am praising and exalting and glorifying the King of the heavens, because all his works are truth and his ways are justice, and because those who are walking in pride he is able to humiliate.
So we can say certainly Nebuchadnezzar has learned his lesson after the 7 years of beast-like behavior. He has come to his senses spiritually. But what is he acknowledging at the end? Well, he's not acknowledging that what he was before, in his pride and his arrogance, blasphemy really against all gods. He's saying, "I myself built this." But at the end, he's not saying that. He's been humiliated. But he's not saying what you would expect he would say if Daniel and the other three youths had done their job as Jehovah's Witnesses, which is to acknowledge that the name of the true God is Yahweh. So how does he designate the true God in his recovery?
In verse 32, he calls him Most High is ruler. The Most High is ruler. And in verse 34, again he calls him Most High, blessed Most High himself, and the one living to time indefinite.
Mine has him who lives forever.
Okay.
And then you notice in the musical part, mine is set to poetry in the next few verses, as if this is a song that he commissioned or wrote himself.
Mm-hmm.
His dominion, his kingdom endures. He does according to his will among the host of heaven. Mm-hmm. And in the last segment, no one can ward off his hand or say to him, what hast thou done? And this royal song, therefore, an ideal opportunity to show that Nebuchadnezzar is truly converted to the God of Israel, whose name is Yahweh.
Yeah.
And the name is completely absent.
He uses pronouns.
Pronouns.
Just pronouns.
Just like Daniel did back in chapter 2.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, his last title, you had, I think, King of the Heavens.
King of the Heavens in verse 37.
New American Standard says King of Heaven. So we're kind of back to where we were in chapter 2.
Mm-hmm.
With the designations.
Right.
So is he further ahead? Yes, in terms of learning the character of God and learning the appropriate response to God.
Yeah.
But in any sense that would make sense to Jehovah's Witnesses' unique badge carrying the name of Jehovah?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
And I think now that we've seen the pattern in the so-called secular chapters where the language is Aramaic, we'll go on to the subsequent chapters. But before we go to the later stories, I think we should revisit some of the stuff in here, because it has to do not just with the badge issue of the name of God that Daniel's people in those days used, or the names, more appropriately, but it also has to do with testing a prophet, because after all, why is Daniel so prominent in the courts of Babylon at this point? It's because he has passed a test that the wise men of Babylon failed.
Yeah.
And so what we want to do is go over the same material from chapters 2 to 4, now looking at another question, which is, how do I know if you are a prophet or a spokesman of God?
Mm. Okay.
What are the divine tests?
Good. All right.
In the next segment.